Oké. Dit is on Wettersee. We zijn exactly in the middle of the course. Also, the fourth lecture, this part, the transforms, I will postpone in week 2 in March 2022.
Yep.
It's not part here, but the coherence is with these parts. Yeah? I suppose it's a basic topic. It's not, it's already quite advanced. But we have discussed yesterday extensively the Fourier transform, continuous time, and now I want to discuss to other members of the transform family the discrete time Fourier transform, continuous time, discrete time. This is for sampled signals. And then a generalized form, which is called the Z-transform. The generalized form of the Fourier transform is the Laplace transform. I showed you this big schematic yesterday, how they are related. Now, only transforms. And many of the things are not new. They just follow they have the same properties and signal pairs as in the Fourier transform. But first, okay, let's make the connection. Okay.
Please go full screen back.
Wait.
Yep.
Okay. One title, contents. This will be the contents. Appendices. Okay. Probably if I have time. Here's some advanced topic. If you have never seen complex functions or so, then this might be some problems, contour integrals. The normal integrals we know are for real numbers, but if you do them for complex numbers, you have to do them in a complex plane. Who has complex function theory, by the way, or complex functions?
I could never deal with complex
functions. Ooh, this is...
But it will be very interesting.
It's very useful, and even I must admit, I'm not fully familiar with it. The names you should remember here, if you look at it in the internet, is again a Frenchman, Cauchy, at the beginning of the 19th century, who was the founder of complex functions. I'm going to write the name now. Okay.
Maybe
that is important.
Yeah.
I put here, okay, there's lots of things here. Complex functions. And okay, there are many books about it, and yeah, this is for mathematics, this is a must. For engineers also, it's very useful. But okay, first a review of and it is lots of formulas. Okay, but a lot of abstract story. The ideal sampling process again. Because we now are dealing with, from now on, it will all be digital. Yeah, sampled signals. And quantization, okay, we have seen, understand continuous amplitude, and we forget about the quantized amplitude. Only keep it in your mind that for a number of computers, they're quantized. So analog amplitudes and discrete times. This is how you create it from analog signals, and the spectrum is then replicated at these points. Now, the relationship, this is the discrete time Fourier transform, the discrete time counterpart of the Fourier transform we saw, is given by this relationship. What is this? And you can rewrite this by putting this behind the summation sign, and then ST times the Dirac function. You know that this is a sampling selecting property, so I can replace the T by NTS. And this is the expression of Fourier transform. And you don't have to, it is not as difficult as you like, as you think. Now, because what is said here is this signal, a discrete signal is nothing else as a linear combination of a whole set of Dirac pulses with each Dirac pulse with this area, this scaling factor. So a whole set of Dirac functions at different heights. That's what. So again, these are the sample values of the. So that's all it means. Now, the frequency spectrum, you take this, and you also can rewrite this by putting this beside, inside the summation sign, and you get this. This is nothing, no, wait a minute, this also inside the summation sign. Now, this convolved with this Dirac function means shifting. So you get a shifted version of the spectrum, replicated shifted version of the spectrum. That's represented here. And if you look at this function here, I can also do a Fourier transform, a normal Fourier transform here. What I do then is these Dirac functions. They transform into this e to the power of minus g to this phase shift factors, this time delay factor. So this is also a representation, a Fourier series representation of the spectrum. So you have two expressions. This one is the most easy to remember, a replication of the again, the ideal sampling process. This is again how to compare it with the Fourier series. Yeah. Maybe now I make things more complicated than. This is exactly the same picture. But now for the Fourier series, for continuous time signal, they're only periodic. And you have the same set of formulas, but now all the parameters have changed. This is the duality property. Not paying attention to this, because this is a Fourier series. We go to the discrete time Fourier transform. Now, this is the time domain expression, and this is rather abstract, but if you write this, if you evaluate this term by term, so n is, I start here with minus 2, minus 1, 0, plus 1, plus 2, and then these are 5 of the successive terms, and of course they go into infinity. This is how you write down a time discrete signal, and you see that this is nothing else than a whole set of Dirac pulses with these values as areas, amplitudes. The corresponding, I still have used this form, spectrum has these terms, these are the one-to-one Fourier transforms of these. The Dirac functions, these are constants, functions. The Dirac functions, they change to phase shift factors here. And this is a frequency periodic spectrum. Oh yeah, this is the operation that is being done here. Now. I can now what I can do, and this is the you can see it as a simple, more simple way to write things down. I replace this e power e to the power of minus replaced by z. It's simply in this case my laziness. I instead of e to the power of z, I set z to the power of z. Z minus 1 is equal to this. This important definition. Because what I have here is the discrete time Fourier transform. But then with z is e to the power of plus this. This means it is z, a complex number z, on the unit circle. That's why I call discrete time Fourier transform the Fourier, the z transform on the unit circle. The z is referring to the z transform already. So this is the relationship. Now there's an enormous set of I don't like it, but I shall explain, and you don't like it either. It is not difficult. Here I've evaluated the sampled signal. You just write everything out in a long line. And this is the same, but instead of the TS, the sampling time, I have only the number of the index number written there. It's also a valid, very valid notation. It's actually the same. And I can also even write it more shorter, because I know that all the Dirac functions are. I can also write it down like this. Only the coefficients, the scaling factors, in the long sequence. And I call this the sequence for this discrete number. Now, if I now use the look at the respective frequency spectrum, then you do the Fourier transform, as you know it, term by term, and you get this sequence. And of course, if I do it here, then I get the same formula. But now the e power is replaced by the power of z. The z on the unit circle. This is a special case. Z transform is later. This is the time Fourier transform. This is the one slide loss of formulas. One of the first things application, we go to revisit convolution again. What happens there? This is the symbolic notation. This is the actual operation. And with these kinds of summations, by the way, it is always gives you more insight that to evaluate a part of the sequence. And you see how this sum of products is written. And you see here that, okay, in the coefficients, the the flipping mechanism that you saw in the first lecture, when you did this shift and this reversing and shifting process. That's what you see here. And normally, you know, this HN is an impulse response. These negative terms you can forget, and you start here. H0, the impulse response at time 0, and this one, that's time 1, and then the first sample, the second delay, this is the sum we shall often meet many times. The transformer, now put it more generic. Z transform looks like this. And this is what I said, the multiplication of two polynomials in Z. And we did this already on Monday. I give you the example, but like the secondary school, the primary school multiplication. Here you have it again. This is what you do, you multiply two polynomials. Yeah? And here it is a convolution operation. Single-sided, as I said, will mean I only start from do it for the positive times, because things that with negative time index, they are things that already have passed. When I start, there's something strange about it. We can look for things that have are still popping up. So this is the Z transform. How it is used in almost all textbooks. This is the notation for a convolution or an impulse response of a filter. This is the impulse response. This is the response, and x is the stimulus.
And the difference between single sided and double sided is the time period
it's in simply,
which we evaluate the sample.
Yeah. The abstract is two-sided, yeah, the Fourier transform is two-sided.
Yes.
That is actually perfect.
Yeah.
And here, yeah, the Laplace transform is the same deficiency. You start only for positive, for non-negative moments. And the Z transform, you only work with positive sample indices. There's a deficiency, and there also the Z-transform will not have the same nice properties as the Fourier transform. Some are the same, like convolution multiplication. They are recognizable, they are almost the same as the Fourier transform, but duality, forget it. There's no duality. The inverse Z-transform, this is the forward Z-transform. The inverse set transform, you have to work with this contour integrals, and this is heavy stuff. You can have a real horror show out of it. So this notation, single sided, and if you want to get rid of the sum sign, you get this as a result. So this output is this times this. The next second output is you have two terms, and then this is three terms, and then four terms, and so on. So you just build up, because there's no information before time t is zero. And you can look it back also in the first day. I showed you this fear filter, this circuit, how to realize this. This now comes back again. Yeah. I only do not have the block schematic here, put it. But besides, it will come soon, this block schematic. It will all come back. the multiplication. you multiply polynomials, you can, this is a nice trick, you can evaluate the multiplication of the polynomials and you, now you know how this goes this times this, this times this, this times this, and when you're ready, you start with this, this times this, this, now, and you get all these terms like in this, and what you do in the end is you add up all the product terms with equal x, x0 you count up, x1 you count up, and then you end up with, I think it is in the, I think yes, it, no, not here.
No, it's here. All the x's, yes.
Yeah, no, no, okay, that, that's x0s, x1s, the x2s,
yeah, yeah.
And you see all these, what you now have to do is the delta 1, delta, the Dirac one sample moment later, two sample moments later, one, two, three sample moments later, you add them all together. What you see here, by the way, is this clever student who saw that you have the diagonal addition. He's more clever than me at that moment. Okay. Yeah, and then you you end up with this this sum. You get this part and this set of terms, this set of terms, this set of terms. And now if you look at the coefficients, then you have in fact the yeah. So then you do it for I is 0, I is 1, I is 2. For I is 0, then this one has a value and this one drops out. For I is 1, this one is a value, the others drop out. And you get this formula, and it is the same as the. Same as this. There's no coincidence. By the way, this is called the impulse response. Just for remembrance, if you put here, make this a Dirac function, delta n. Then, yeah, then all these terms, they vanish. And you only left with this one, and this is correct. This is the value of the stimulus at time zero is only a Dirac function, and then this one. No, you cannot see that from here. Z-domein, de complex, complex frequency, to the power of, then the x, the input stimulus as this, the z-transform, and the impulse response has this z-transform, and the output has this z-transform, and of course the objective is to express this in terms of x and h, and this is the same, but then doing it in polynomials again. Now, then you get here the, yeah, the same exercise here. Product, you see a sum of two products, sum of three products. This is all the same, and okay. concluded is. You have the exactly the same equations. Now you see them here from the Z-transform coefficients. And okay, this was a lot of formulas, but now I put into remembrance again, we saw something we saw in the first lecture, first day. Here you have your time index. Here you have an impulse response, h of n, 1, 2, 3, 4. You remember this sawtooth that we had one before. Then 1 on 1. And now we're going to do convolution. And we all have seen that this is the result. You see here these diagonals. You have here this this product, you have here the sum of 2 products, sum of 3 products, sum of 4 products, sum of 3 products, okay, this cannot be more than 3, and here the sum of 2 and sum of 1, and if you add them up, then you get this famous answer again, but now written in terms of sampled signals, and the simple recipe, and then you multiply these polynomials, and you get this, and you end up with this one, and you see that the coefficients are the same as the outputs of the convolution. So you see here the convolution and the multiplication, you put them together, they deliver the same result, except this. This is in the world of polynomials and in terms of Z. This is in the terms of samples. This is the discrete time. Is everybody still here?
Yes, it is.
This is a rather abstract piece, but I suggest you, you can reread it slowly. It is just the analogy and the relation, between polynomials in Z and the world of time samples, and also now related to the Fourier transform, the discrete time, and then the Z domain, which on the unit circle will be periodic still. You can walk around the unit circle, and then every time, with 2 pi, you get repetition. So the periodicity of the spectrum is there. Okay, now a formal approach, and I think this is more accessible than the previous part, so it is not intuitive at all. I should put it in between quotes. No. Okay, we go do the same thing for a Z-transform as for a Fourier transform. We have, the quality symmetry, we walk through all the properties and with some elementary examples, and not as extensive as Fourier transform, many things you will recognize. First, the quality. Yeah, of course, there is not, because you have this one-sided transform, as you can see here, it's still two-sided. But even if it is two-sided, then this is frequently used. Normally you start here counting at 0 time index. The inverse transform looks like this. And if you look at this, you will not be happy. Because if you want to compute the value of a certain time sample, you have to do some very rather abstract operation on this complex number. This is an operation, and for people who are familiar with, you have to look for residues in your complex plane where this function goes to infinity. And you walk in a closed loop in which all these singularities are encompassed, shortly in words. I'm not going to give a course in complex functions theory to you here, but I'll give you some results, and they are in the appendix. We know, and I rarely use it, and I advise you never to use this formula, unless you are a hobbyist mathematician. Okay, this formula for the Z-transform. Now, if I take Z is e to the power of minus g to the power of it, then I'm walking on the unit circle. Z is a complex number. But if I take a subset of Z on the unit circle, then I can replace, and I can replace Z by this. And here, for convenience, I can, this is a function of f. So I can also write this, but actually this is the correct notation. All text, almost all textbooks use this. A better thing in terms of this, but because here you see the periodicity of your spectrum, because this is just an e power which repeats itself every 2 pi radians. Normally this is used, but this is what actually is meant, and this is nothing else as a, like a sum of, not this one, this as the sum of the sum of phase shifts and the sample. This is the discrete time Fourier transform as a special case of the Z-transform. And now also the inverse Z-transform becomes then the inverse DTFT. It's now the formula is not that abstract anymore, because it becomes now an integral over a line, not over a complex, the complex plane, so because f is real. Now this is the expression for the inverse discrete time Fourier transform. And this is over one period, because the spectrum is periodic, and the signal is sampled, of course. And these have something more, far more resemblance to the Fourier transform itself. It's not symmetric, it's not the same expression, this and this, but you see more relationship. It's not, there's no duality, that's for sure. The other part, symmetry. Yes, there is also a type of symmetry, but also this is looks a bit weird. This because this e power. Now, this is the relationship, sets of samples and polynomials, polynomial. If this is minus n, it is not minus z, it is z to the minus 1. And for the complex conjugate, you add these two, it is x complex conjugate times z complex conjugate. And if you should add this up, then you get a real number. If you add this up, you get you would automatically get a real number. If this is an even signal, yeah, then this is a real number as well. If this is an odd number, then this becomes an imaginary number. But let's compare them to DFT. Then you see it's immediately obvious where this mystic properties come from. If you have the DFT, the discrete time Fourier transform, then I replace the Z by this e to the power minus G again. What I see then, this of course, also this is the reference, then if this is a minus,
I put then this plus changes to minus. This becomes minus f, and this is a result that we recognize from the Fourier transform as well. This is indeed, this is a symmetry relationship between even and odd. And for the Fourier transform, I put here, then this, you have these relationships, and this is from this table which I sketch you with all these arrows, and with even odd, and imaginary even, imaginary odd, the symmetry properties. This one I meant, yeah, okay. discrete, but now I have the discrete time domain and the periodic frequency domain. And this is then for the PTFT, not for the Z-transform, but for the discrete time transform. You have exactly the same properties as for the Fourier transform. Symmetry. Duality, no, but symmetry, yes. Same relationships. And okay, if to make up the discrete time domain, I have it's real. If you take a complex, these are still complex values, real and G imaginary. You take G imaginary. This is just to define what is the complex conjugate mean. It's just the change of sign. Yeah, if you add them up, there you end up with the real number, 2 times the real part, and here also 2 times the real part. But this is not extra information. Reciprocity. Reciprocity means time shift in one domain is phase shift in the frequency domain. How does that work in the discrete time domain and the Z domain, polynomial domain? This is the reference again. If I shift my sample, then I multiply by Z to the minus N0. Now, this is in fact exactly the same as in the Fourier transform. So a time shift here means multiplication with Z to the minus something of the original polynomial. And the other way around, which is not so much used, if you multiply your sequence of samples with and for each moment of this exponential z to the power of n, then you have to z0 of course is a constant, then you have to define z by z0. This is rather strange at first sight, of course not if you now compare it to the discrete time Fourier transform as a special case, then you immediately see where it comes from. Okay, here I have, but this will come later, this is a special set transform pair, which will come after this, with the time signal, this key time signal is a step function. Is that so? Yes, then if I do the step function and I scale every, it becomes a negative exponential decreasing set of z values. Then this is the formula I think I'm too far ahead here, because this will have to come, these are the algebraic formulas that are going to come. This is relevant. If you have look at the discrete time Fourier transform, then the reciprocity, as you see it here, is this is the reference formula. Then time shifting, do like this. Now it means Dirac function, of course, convolved. This one is transformed into e power times this one. This is this. This should be a minus sign. Is that correct? This is a minus sign, of course, because I have here a time shift in the to the future, and this should be a minus sign. This interpreted is a plus, and this is a minus sign, and this, of course, is a minus sign as well. And this is just the variable again. So this is the what you'd also do in the Fourier transform, and this multiplication here, what you do in the DTFT is multiplying this, and this is what you do in amplitude modulation. Now amplitude modulation of a sampled signal, and this multiplication changes it to a frequency shift, of course. And amplitude modulation is frequency shift, and what you by manipulation, you have here this e power, which is a better notation than this, and you can this split this variable in this time in two separate powers of e, and then this becomes an expression, and this relates to this formula. That's why you do here the division by z0. From this, it is, I would say obvious. It's very, you can understand it quite easily, but it's rather abstract. It's more like a list of learning by heart. By the way, the students that I had, they got the exams. They had an open book exam. They could they got a whole table of these z-transforms, so they do not have to learn this by heart. And if you ask me. If you ask me a month later, and then I do not know, I've forgotten all these formulas myself also. This one, not. This one you use frequently. Okay, the other I give for completeness. They all have dual counterparts. Scaling. That's an interesting. This is one that is rarely used, but okay, for completeness, I mention it. If I scale the axis, I just replace the samples over my axis of my time axis, and what I do here, if I and the result of this expansion is that all the samples you have done here are placed k apart instead of k time sampling moments apart instead of one sampling moment, and the result is this reference is that the outcome is z to the power of k. Time compression works similar. This is and it means that for the result I have a whole sequence that I only take each kth sample and I discard the rest. So this is kind of, downsampling. This will be come back in multi-rate signal processing. Both these these processes, interpolation and decimation. Here are the examples to clarify it a bit. what you do here, you replace the samples x2 and for case 2, and you have two zeros every time in between. And the other way to discard, then you have if you have these indices, then you give the samples new indices, and you get x0, x3, x6, and the rest you discard. That's what you do in downsampling. Okay, the not the DFT form, but now the Fourier transform. If you compare them, then you see here
The beauty of mathematics. So
how these two have these formulas, and we know this from the scaling. Here you expand the time axis, and here you compress the frequency axis. And this is the other way around. Here you compress the time axis and expand the frequency axis. From the Fourier transform, it's very symmetric, very beautiful.
So do.
Yeah. Yeah, this is a remark here. Do not confuse this with the reciprocity. Yeah. That is easily to be done, because you see here lots of z powers of variables here before. You get easily mixed up, so that's why everyone gets a table with the z transform. Linearity. I can be very quick. This is exactly the same. I have two sequences of samples with the respective polynomials. So here I can make a linear combination of linear combination of these two sample sequences. And in the Z-domain, I can do exactly the same operation. I do not have to explicitly compute this. I can construct this from these two. This is called superposition. This is a property of linearity, superposition of signals. And this notation here, which we used in this first chapter, if I write this like this, this signal is this sample plus delayed sample, two times delayed sample. What you here in fact have is a linear combination of functions. This is the most trivial example you have, and what you here have is the corresponding linear combination in the polynomial domain. This is not a difficult slide. Next slide is somewhat difficult, but rarely used. Do I say it correctly? Yes, because most of the things they follow from the other properties you've already seen. But, this one is a strange one. If you multiply the sample by its index, then the polynomial you have to do times z. And then the derivative of z of the spectrum that you have. This one is something we will use very often. This is the output. What you do here is you add up from 0 to n, a whole set of xk to xn. and in fact, I think this should be infinity. And the polynomial relationship, the corresponding output polynomial will be the input polynomial times this one. To kind of forehead you in, you introduce a pole here where this goes to infinity. The difference, it's something easier to see if you have x n and x minus 1, then this, okay, translate to xz, and x minus 1 translate to z minus 1 xz. That is the time shifting property we saw some slides before. This also, but especially this, is something you will see many times in the Z transform. This type of relationships. Okay, I have here some proofs, but maybe I can walk through them with you. Okay, given xz, here the double sided notation, doesn't matter that much. Now we take the derivative to z. It means that taking the derivative of z, I move this derivative inside, like this. Okay, solve this, then I end up with this sequence, minus n, z minus n minus 1. And now I manipulate back this n outside the combine with the xn, and then here I end up with z minus n, and the z minus 1, which is independent of this index, put out of sight of the from the sum sign, and then you arrive at this formula. Yeah, it's a manipulation of in the indices, and don't make mistakes, it's easy to make. So here is something similar. Here you have the okay, the output, the result of the sum. What happens then in the polynomial domain? This one is x, was xz, now it replaces by the sum. You get a sum of a sum, and then this z to the power of minus n. You evaluate this sum, like this, over book. Then you do, term for term, you do transform. You get this one, and this one is z minus 1, and this one is delayed. 2, z minus 2, and you can rewrite this. You take this outside brackets, and we end up with the sum of 1, z minus 1, z minus 2. And this is one of the things you should recognize. This is a geometric sequence. If you have 1 plus z minus 1, z minus 2, you can rewrite it like this. Is that strange to you? I shall refresh your mind, because this is... I'm not sure that... let me see that. Okay, I use this here. What I said was 1 plus z minus 1 plus z minus 2. Plus z minus 3 plus going to infinity, and I have to prove that this comes out. Now, what's the trick? But I'm sure you've seen this before. I call this, what do you mean? I call this A. Abbreviated to A. Now, I can do A to the power of minus z. Okay, I just write it in a convenient way. This is z minus 1 plus z minus 2 plus z minus 3 plus
and so on until doomsday infinity. Now, if I now if I now subtract that, then immediately you see the result. You get a times 1 minus z minus 1. Yeah, I subtract this, a minus az minus 1, and I take the brackets here. And if I subtract this polynomial from this polynomial, big surprise, not a surprise at all, you're left with 1. The other terms cancel one another out. Now, and this, of course, a is 1 divided by 1 minus z minus 1. Now, and so this sequence is the same. So this is how this sequence translates into this expression. A very simple derivation, but very essential. This geometric sequence. I think I did not include it originally. I gave Kamen, Kozarev, yesterday he copied some files from me, and I advised also to copy a PDF file of some mathematic essentials which I added but not treated. In the original schedule I put 0 hours because I think, okay, I do not treat this, you should know this, but I think it's good to have a memory for your memory to that you can look it up. But the geometric sequence is one of the essentials, just like complex numbers and goniometry. This is the proof, and okay, here I have proven this relationship. In fact, and also this is also what you see. That is 1 over 1 minus z minus 1. Die doen we ook symmetric. Nou, convolution multiplication. This, in fact, is identical to the Fourier transform and the discrete time Fourier transform. If you have here two sequences, you can do convolution. If you have here two polynomials, you can multiply them. Okay, you've seen that, how to do that. And illustration, okay. Here you multiply sequences and so that's clear. The other way around, that is doing convolutions. Okay. Multiplication of sequences. Of sample sequences. You have to do the convolution of these two. And to write this out, you have this horrible contour integral again. Okay, then you have to solve this. Rarely used. Or better say, never used at all. That's the best. Always a bipod. I can say something about it. If you, these are equal. And, or this this one is a complex conjugate of this one. So I have the energy relationship again. This is the energy in the discrete time domain, and this contour integral gives me the energy in the z domain. Yes.
What is that the theta level represents here?
Wait a minute.
Yeah,
the zeta.
Yes.
Ah, that's a symbolic, belonging to the integral.
Ah, yes.
This z is
constant. Ja, het is de parameter, het is only a running parameter following the. And
yeah, the notation of the contour integral.
Yep, yeah, yeah, yeah. It's the. It's what, yeah, this delta zeta. Yeah, that is. But forget about these formulas. You've seen them for completeness. You need to forget them. We'll never use them. Okay, this brings to a conclusion for the properties. You see, this is much faster than the Fourier transform. There's lots of similarities and also irregularities. It's not symmetric. Here you have the time sequences, and here you have the transforms and the relationships. Forget about this for the moment, because this tells you something about convergence and divergence and stability, which is not the case yet. This is a table from Shams outlines from the sequence of systems. A good summary of the properties, I would say. Not any questions still? Not yet. No, there can't be, because only if you see examples or do things yourself, the Z-transform is quite practical to use. And once you get used to it, you forget where it came from. Just like engineers do. You do something, it works, but you don't know why it works. And scientists work the other way around. You know, have to know why it works, and you don't bother how it works. No.
In
your case, you're a scientist, the Fourier transform, that is what you normally use. The Z-transform is a specific application. We'll come to that for tomorrow and the day after tomorrow in digital systems and digital filters, which is a subclass of digital systems. There it is used to, and you see, to analyze and to build digital systems and filters. This is very dedicated to this area. Fourier transform is much more fundamental. It will pop up again also in spatial Fourier transform. I do not have a spatial Z transform. Yeah, no. This is only dedicated to designing filters. So tomorrow and Friday will be more engineering dedicated lectures, but especially Friday and Thursday about systems. There is also something that pure science can be valuable. And on Friday, it's really about building something. The difference between applications. Fourier transform is much more fundamental and wider applicated. This were only the properties. Sorry, I thought this. We started at 1:30, so we have a short break. So I can continue. It's not much, by the way.
Let's conclude with the applications if you're okay with it. Yes, and then make some break.
Well. Yeah. Well, first I go to here and then see how your state of mind
is.
And here you get, for engineers, the interesting things. But, then I continue with the Z-transform pairs. Okay. You see some characteristic pairs, and some of them you automatically learn by heart. It's not difficult, by the way, that is approaching. The computations are rather simple. You follow the rules. If you have an overview, I have the Dirac pulse, of course, the unit step function, the rectangle, and the negative exponential.
And then again, the complex harmonic, and then the real harmonics, cosine, sine. Then the ramp, slope, the ramp, parabolic, the one of the n harmonic. These are more rare. These two sets are okay, quite important also for writing stimuli in the discrete domain. Okay, let's pay attention. Not to embarrass you, but I made a diagram how all these relationships are related themselves. Yeah, that is the if a Dirac pulse, if the unit step, which is just a repeated set of Dirac pulses, in this case, with discrete time, you can have a unit step which is not flat but exponential decreasing. You can have a unit step which is truncated, so it's a rectangle. You can make it a ramp, a slope, not a flat. The exponential decreasing you can also truncate. You get a finite length exponential. From the exponential decreasing, this is important, you can create the complex harmonic. And from the complex harmonic, of course, the sine and the cosine. Just how they all these pairs are related. This is the Dirac pulse, and how do you at the kth moment? So this is later Dirac pulse to moment the kth moment k, and for it the z transform is z to the minus k, just like that. If k is 0, then this is 1. Then the unit step function is just a whole sequence of these pulses. Now, you can write this as a sum, so you have all the sequences one by one, and you have this relationship, which I computed here. And if you want to get rid of z minus 1, you multiply by z, everything, numerator and denominator, and you get this expression. Both expressions are important later on, but for engineering. This is of course correct. This one we need later on for computing poles and zeros. Poles, this is, you have a z-transform function with this expression. Then this expression gives you, for z is 1, it becomes infinity high is a pole, and for z is 0. It is 0, it is it's a 0. Yeah. Now, you can make a rectangle. You take a unit step function minus a delayed unit step function, which is the opposite sign, and you end up with a finite length sequence of Dirac pulses. Now, you can do it also one by one. And now you end up with a similar expression, but now somewhat more terms. Should I do that again? Yes, sir? Yeah? No. Okay, then we add something. Yeah, okay, this is the better one. Now I do it the same color, otherwise it becomes a mess.
This is infinite. If I now put here plus z n minus 1, minus of course, like this. Okay. I multiply this, then I get here plus z n z minus n. Truncate sequence. This addition is still value, but now this becomes something different. It's 1. This one, minus z minus 1. Okay. And this one is 1 minus. This expression becomes that expression. You can check it, of course. And if the n's go to infinity, this goes to zero. And we have the same expression as here. So you should easily check.
Yeah?
So we have this expression. And this is for computing pulse zeros later on in when you design digital systems and filters. This expression. So a truncated finite length series of equal height Dirac pulses. If the Dirac pulses are not of equal height, but are infinitely long and now exponentially decreasing, because one of the is that so? No, when it is when it is infinite length, one of the demands is that a is smaller than one. Otherwise, my infinitely long series explodes. Here you already see some foreshadowing of the criterion for stability. Right? The values in a exponential, this is a geometric sequence, but this is a geometric sequence, a squared. And the value of a, the criterion has to be smaller than 1. If it is 1, then you get this one, and then you're on the edge of stability, because this one goes on forever, it will not grow, it will not decrease, it will be there. If you write this in the notation, you have here a unit step function, and each sum of the unit step function gets a weight a to the power of n, its time index. And okay, this is how you can write it. This is the coefficient and this is the Dirac function. Set transform means, okay, the constant remain, this one transforms into z minus k. And if you look at the same form, this formula, or just this formula, sorry, then you see that this one translates into this one. And what you also can see, okay, then this is the conclusion. It's the same as this one. What you also can see, if you take the, these factors together, you have a times z. Z divided by A, I must say, no. Okay, forget about it. This is the expression. This is what you look for to find poles and zeros. And for Z is A, the whole thing explodes. That's what it says here. Now the other one, that is the finite length, so the truncated exponential sequence. You have a sequence and you subtract from this the same sequence down somewhat later. And okay, then this becomes the expression. So you start at k is 0 and then you end up n moments later, at n minus 1. You do the same trick. This is a linear combination, and because this linear combination, you do this z transform, use this, because this term. Okay, you apply this trick again, and you have this term. You go effect from this to this. That's, well, it's all simple manipulations. And you can, of course, you can write this in positive powers of z to compute the poles and zeros. Now it becomes already more interesting. You have here a pole at z is a, and the pole at z is a zero. And where is the zero? Now then you have to solve a very nice equation. Z to the power of n is some constant. Now this is an equation that we should solve. This touches to the fundamentals of algebra, solving equations. But we postpone that, we need to tomorrow.
Okay, these are some of the most occurring common settled forms, not more. It is not the whole list. The one that is failing here is the complex harmonic. Now, that means that you multiply the unit step function, we only use positive time functions, with this. But you can rewrite this as this, and this is Z transform to get this. Now, this factor, previous slide, then you end up with this formula. They're all similar. You get this formula. The exercise proof this relationship. Okay, this is for the students. Next slide is the answer, so you can maybe just skip them and let you do it yourself. No, this is not not the intention. I can split this, of course, in real and imaginary part. The real part is cosine, and I have to do. And okay, this is really okay. Lots of work, and you have to be very careful about signs. And this is the outcome of the Z transform. This is the Z transform of a cosine, which starts at time zero, and for the sine, you get something similar. I do not demand from the students that they remember these type of formulas. This is nonsense. You get this in the table. But you can derive it from this one, just as this one came from the previous formula. This one is from splitting this in real imaginary part. And this one, arrive at splitting in real and imaginary part. It's quite straightforward. These are the solutions. Now, it is lots of work. Let's now walk through them shortly. Of course, here you recognize this sequence with negative exponential, and you do this, and then in the end you replace this by. Straightforward. This one is less obvious. You have to evaluate this expression. This expression. Now, the normal trick of this. You see here a plus sign, and you multiply this by a factor. It's only a dirty trick what I do. So this plus sign of here, you have the similar factor here, but now with a minus sign. And look what happens. If you write this out, you get here the double product, and here you get Z minus 2. Then you have already the denominator there. And now you work out this, split this in real imaginary part, cosine G sine. Now this one plus cosine, is the real part, and this is the imaginary part. You see them. Okay, it's a lot of work, but to be very precise, but then you have this formulas. What do I write here? Yeah, okay, you can even get it more complicated. You can have a complex harmonic, which is exponential decreasing. You can create all types of composite signals. Shall I do that solution? No. There are several ways of solving this. I skip this. This does not give you any information. You can walk through the computations. This is one of the basic tricks to solve it. Remember what you know from geometric sequences. You were able to solve, in fact, almost all of these problems. Okay, there's some left which I go quickly because you never use them. There is a ramp up and it is n times unit step function, and this you apply one of the properties. Okay, times this, and here you do this manipulation again, and you end up with a square here. You can do this also with a parabolic. You do instead of n square, you do n square here, and you end up something like this, and you get here a third power, and so on and so on and so on. And okay, you can here combine this negative exponential with a ramp function. So prove this relationship. Yeah, this is only specific exercises for the students. Yeah, solutions are here. Now I can bother you with the grammar. There's one to conclude, and it has no value. No, it is a value, but I still want to mention it. If you have a sequence, 1/2, 1/3, 1/4, 1/5, like this, in step function and this, you can write it like this. And of course, this step is obvious, but we write it this way. Yeah. There's something strange about this series. I suppose you've seen this. This is called a harmonic sequence. And if you add up all these terms, they go to infinity. That is the, if it is 1/2, 1/4, 1/8, and if it is a geometric sequence, you have a finite result of the sum. But this has an infinite result. It's infinitely large. And you end up with this expression, and it has a relationship with what I said, the Euler's constant. And this is the error of the deviation you have when you do this sum from the logarithmic function. And you can add this up, and it's more and more it resembles the natural logarithm. Without ever reaching it, in the end, you always are left with the residue of gamma, almost constant. And, okay, for mathematicians, these are formulas, okay, to keep it to see a relationship between what happens here and happens in calculus, mathematics in calculus. Has no related, no practical application, but I still want to mention what happens when you see this. The transform pairs, they're not the elementary pairs, they're all the pairs there are. You see them here all summarized. For the moment, you see this horrible cosine expression, but now you know it's not horrible at all. It just follows from the previous ones. That's it. And these are the tools that, or the pairs and the properties that you have to deal with the Z transform. And some remarks about the inverse Z transform. No, it's not some remarks. I think it's better to have break now.
Yes. Yeah.
Because so this is one more. This is more time than it's not 2 minutes. The others are short. We have a break now. Okay.
Thank you.
Why
met mathematical stuff. But, especially this is one of the bottlenecks of the Z-transform. How to solve these problems? You have a solution in the Z-transform, but now you have to go back to the time domain. Yeah, now you have I'm in trouble. How do we do that? Now you have four methods. And the most lazy one, that is the engineering one, you just use a lookup table, ready. If you don't have it, then you have to use other measures. And the last one is the most horrible. Yeah. Okay. Like this.
Yeah.
This is important. And okay, Kahneman and Peter also. Kahneman for sure has his mathematical necessities.
Yeah. I'm trying to.